Okay, hello friends, this is Yusuf here. Welcome to part 6 of our crash course AWS serverless. So in this video we're going to see how to create a post endpoint to be connected with the lambda function. So before that, a quick recap of what all we have done now. So we have created the API gateway for our tutorial, and we initially saw how to create a get and post endpoint in API gateway, and we created with the mock endpoint, right? Then we created a lambda, and we connected the get function or get API gateway method to the lambda function. And the lambda function, we have seen how to directly return the response if the proxy integration is not on, okay? Which means here in the integration request, if it is a proxy integration, then the whole request will come to the lambda function, and we need to return the response in a specific format. The format is nothing but a JSON with the status code, and a body should have a stringified response, then that should work. Now what we are going to do, we are going to create another lambda function which is to handle the post method, okay? Let's go to the lambda function and go up, go to functions, let's create a function. So let's give it a name as demo post lambda. Let it be Node.js. Create a function. So while it's creating, let's go back to API gateway, and we already have the post method we created as part of our earlier video. If you click on that, currently this post endpoint is returning the mock response, right? So we're going to change this endpoint and connect to our new lambda function. So if you go to demo lambda, it's created. Let's come down. Let me make it bigger. So as usual, we'll make our context and callback style of returning. And here I don't want to return anything. I just say callback null comma some response. Okay, this response equal to response from post lambda. Okay, nothing big. Okay, let's because we want to see what is going to be this event object if the calling function is a post endpoint. Okay, first let's save this, and we also going to do now console log of the event object, okay, just to see what is there. Okay, save it, and in the API gateway under the post endpoint, go to integration request. Now we'll change from mock to lambda function, and here we'll select our AP Southeast one. Okay, and here if you type demo, we get our post lambda, and save. Okay, I don't know what is that error. It's taking some time. Okay, it's done. So now we are directly going to test it, okay, because now this post function is connected to a lambda, and if we test, we are going to see what's going to happen. So click test. Now as usual, we get the access to the request body. I'm going to type in some request body, like I can test and test message, okay, simply, and then click test. So we get response from post lambda, which is what we expected, right? Because the lambda is responding with this particular message. But what happened to this request body, and what was received into the event object? We want to check that. For that, let's go back and then click on monitoring and view logs in CloudWatch. So here we should be able to see the logs which we just invoked from the API gateway, right? So under the log group, give it some time. Okay, so here it is. So one log group created, and inside that you can see basically the test message is what printed here, which means in the console log, we are logging the event object, right? So that event object is nothing but the request payload, okay? So to make it more clear, what I'm going to do, instead of sending the response, I'm going to send the event directly as a response. Okay, so if you save it, and let's come back to our AP Gateway. Now I'm going to test the whole AP Gateway with the same body and everything. Okay, if you click test, and if you see, our whatever we send in the request body, we received it. Okay, so the first point to be clarified is, if it is a post endpoint, then whatever we are giving in the request body, that will be passed to the event object. Okay, now we're going to see a small exception. Okay, let's click on method method execution, and here come to the integration request, and coming down we have a mapping template. Okay, let's click on that. Okay, I'm going to give the second option when there is no mapping template defined, then I'm going to add a mapping template as applications.json. Click OK and down. Now we have a place to give a mapping. Okay, now I'm just going to say that name Yusuf. Okay, I'll explain why I'm doing that. Okay, let me close this one and save it. Go back. Now let's try to test again. So again we are testing with the same test payload, and we're going to test it, but what we have done is we have created a mapping template. Okay, click test. And what we see is the name Yusuf as response, which means the Lambda has received this object under the event, object, this payload in the event object. But even though we give a request body different, but we get this as response, which means whatever is present in the integration request, that is going to be the input to the Lambda function. Okay, so regardless of what we are sending, this is going to be the input. So why it is important? If at all we want to do some kind of manipulation or a transformation, we can do that in integration request. Okay, let me give one example. So say for example, the incoming JSON is having the key value pair like name. Let me give an example here. Okay, so assume we are getting the payload like name to Yusuf. Okay, but we want to pass this as username to the Lambda function. Okay, how do we do that? Okay, let's see that now in action. Okay, let's go to method execution in integration request. If you come down, basically what we want to pass, we want to pass a username. Okay, assume our Lambda function is expecting a username thing. Okay, if we blindly keep like this, right, what will happen, it will always pass username as user. But what we want the value of the name attribute in the request body and replace it into the use of this particular place. Okay, so how to do that? So basically we will get access to that request body using a syntax like $ input dot path. Okay, in the path I can make a single quotes and you can give a $. So this $ means the whole request body. Okay, what I mean is whole request body. If you just save this and let's come back and test it. Okay, so we are passing the name Yusuf as a request body, but we have done some mapping template changes, and if you click test, now the response, what you see, it's not able to parse. Okay, I'll tell the reason why. Okay, let's go back, integration request, let's take it as JSON. Okay, save. I'll tell the difference between JSON and path in a second. Okay, test it. Test. So now we got the response that username, under the username we have the actual payload we passed. Okay, name Yusuf is coming as a value to the username key. This is because in the mapping template we provide that username is going to be the $, right? So $ input dot JSON of $. The dollar means the whole object. If you want to get only the name attribute, so I can go in the integration request here. We'll say that we are targeting $in.name. Okay, then only the value will come and place into here. Okay, if you save it, come back and test it. Now if we test, now we see username is Yusuf as a event object, right? Because now what happens, this name attribute is been now extracted in the integration request and then substituted. Okay, now let's understand the difference between $in.path and $in.json. okay, so it's very simple. So what I'm going to do now, I'm going to provide a number here. Okay, let me change it to age and 10. Okay, this is going to be my JSON payload, and here in the integration request. Let's come down. So here I'm going to change to age. Okay. So here I say simply dollar sign input dot path inside a single quotes and dollar sign dot age. Okay. So we are trying to extract the age from the request body and assign it to maybe here we have a different user age. Okay. So what we are expecting user age, then the value from the request body should be passed to the lambda function. Okay. Save it, come back and test it. So we pass age 10, let's see what happens. So we get user age 10. So here we don't find any problem, okay, but what is the difference? So now if you want to pass this as a string, okay, let's go back and integration request. Okay, if you want to pass that as a string, what we need to do, we need to give a double quotes from the whole thing. Okay, the whole expression should be under double quotes. Now what will happen, let's quickly see. Save it, go back and test it. So now again we pass the same 10 without double quotes or single quotes. So if we test it, so we see the result as a double quotes. Okay, so if you use a dollar sign dot path, then it will only try to give you the value. Okay, it won't give the value as a string. So if at all you want to convert that to a string, you need to enclose everything with a double quotes. Okay, but if you don't want to do that, we can use dollar sign dot json. Okay, in that case we don't want to provide a double quotes, it will always give us a string. Okay, so basically you can take out this one and here you can give json. Okay, now it's guaranteed that the value will be a string. Okay, so let's save it, go back and test it, come down, test. Now we pass without single quotes and but we get the actual the JSON to be passed. Okay, since it is a number, it's sending directly. If it is suppose a string, right, which means we should be getting string, which also means in the same format, if we try to go to integration request and convert that to a path, okay, without any double quotes, okay, save it, go back and test it. Now see what happens. So now see, it only gets the value. That is the difference. Okay, even though if you give as a string, the request dot, sorry, the dollar sign dot path will only give the value, but the dollar sign dot json will give you the data type, okay, which is string, which means you'll get a string. Okay, so I hope that is not confusing for you, but you can stick with one pattern. Dollar sign dot json is a common way of using it, so that you can stick with that. Okay, so this is what I want to cover in this video: how to connect to a post function, and importantly, how to do some manipulation on the request payload. Okay, in the next video, we are going to see the introduction of DynamoDB, and then we'll see how to create a table and how to add record. And how do we do some operations from Lambda function to DynamoDB, and we'll proceed further. Okay, so that's it for this video. I hope it is interesting for you. You're able to follow along. If you have any questions or comments, you can put that in the comment section. Okay, thanks for watching.